Hello everyone. So today, as you can see behind me, we are going to discuss the scanner of the Partnership Act for CA Foundation. Before I start with this, I'm not going into the practical, theory questions. The reason being that I had already posted a video on the theory part. I mean, the entire revision of the entire chapter just prior to this. So we already know about the theory part. So I'm not going into the theory questions. However, in this, we are going to discuss the practical questions so that it's a little easy for us to write in the exams when we are writing for the exams. So starting with the questions. The first question states the difference between partnership and HUF. Not going into this, it's a very, very theoretical question. We've already discussed this in the class also. What is the conclusive evidence of partnership? State the circumstances when partnership is not considered between two or more parties. What is the conclusive evidence of partnership? We already know mutual agency. In fact, in the revision video also I had told you about mutual agency, that it is the cardinal principle. In fact, this is one feature which does not exist in any other form of business. So if mutual agency is there, we can say partnership exists. State the circumstances when partnership is not considered between two or more persons. If they don't have any record or terms about any sort of a partnership, they don't have banking accounts, they don't have accounts which can be inspected by each of them, we can say there is no partnership. Now, X, Y, and Z are partners in a partnership firm. X introduced A, a manager, as his partner to Z. A remains silent. This shows that this person is not the partner, but he is represented as a partner. This is known as partner by estoppel. When a person is not a partner of the firm, but a partner represents him as such, and he remains silent. Z, a trader, believing A as partner, supplied 100 TV sets to the firm on credit. After expiry of the credit period, Z did not get the amount of the TV sets sold to the partnership firm. Z filed a suit against X and A for the recovery of the price. Advise Z whether he can recover the amount from X and A under the Indian Partnership Act. Partnership Act says that a partner by estoppel is that when a partner represents another person as a partner, though in fact he is not a partner of the firm, he becomes a partner by estoppel and his liability shall be severe. His liability shall be severe. Severe means he can be held liable for the entire contract. So can he recover the amount from X and A? Yes. Z can recover the money from X and A. And discuss the provisions regarding personal profits earned by a partner under the Partnership Act. So here, what is the concept of personal profits? If a partner earns any personal profits from any transaction of the firm or by using the name or assets of the firm or from any personal business competing with the firm, so in these cases, if a partner earns any personal profits from any transaction of the firm or using the name or assets of the firm or from any personal business competing with the firm, such profit, he has to give a share of it to the other partners. In what ratio do we share? We share it in the PSR. So the other partners in the same PSR that they share the partnership profit, they will get this profit. So, if a partner derives any profits for himself from any transaction of the firm or from the use of property or business connections of the firm or the firm name, he shall account for that profit and pay it to the firm. If a partner carries on any business of the same nature and competing with that of the firm, he shall account for and pay all the profits to the firm made from that business. Whether a group of person is or is not a firm, or whether a person is or is not a partner, explain the mode of determining the existence as per the Partnership Act. We already know that for partnership, what is needed? There should be an agreement. Then there should be a business. Then there should be a sharing of profits. And final and most importantly, there should be mutual agency. Sharing of profits between two or more people can suggest the existence of partnership. After these two things are present, sharing of profits can suggest the existence of partnership between two or more persons. But then the whole point is that even if a partner may not be a part, even a person may not be a partner of the firm, he can still share the profit. So sharing of profit is an evidence, but it is not the conclusive evidence. It is a prima facie evidence. But if mutual agency, that is one does the act and binds the whole firm, if mutual agency is present, then we can conclusively say that yes, there is a partnership. The next one. A, B and C are partners of a partnership firm, ABC and Company. The firm is a dealer in office furniture. A was in charge of purchase and sale. B was in charge of maintenance of accounts of the firm, and C was in charge of handling all legal matters. Recently, through an agreement among them, it was decided that A will be in charge of maintenance of accounts and B will be in charge of purchase and sale. Being ignorant about such an agreement, M, a supplier, supplied some furniture to A, who ultimately sold them to a third party. Referring to the provisions of the Partnership Act 1932, advise whether M can recover the money from the firm. What will be your advice in case M was having knowledge about the agreement? See, the whole thing is, anything that happens between the partners is something which is internal to them. If you remember, in the revision video also, I had talked about extension or restriction of implied authority. They have an agreement that one person will be doing a particular job and the other person will do another particular job, and they changed it. And this agreement is something which is internal to them. This agreement of change of business or change of the nature or the change of authority is something which is internal to them. How does it affect the outsiders? If the outsiders know about it, they are bound by it. However, if the outsiders do not know about it, how will I know? It is internal. How will I know? So if it is not known, I am not bound. So A, who referring to the provisions, advise whether Mr. M can recover the money from the firm. Yes, because he was not aware. However, what will be your answer in case M was having knowledge? Then he cannot recover. Why? Because he already has knowledge about it. So when a third party dealing with the firm has knowledge, he is bound. But if he has no knowledge, he is not bound. So thus M can recover the money from the firm. However, if M was aware of the change in the authority, he shall not be bound by the terms of the agreement. He shall also be bound by the terms of the agreement and cannot recover the money from the firm. In the absence of any usage or custom of trade to the contrary, the implied authority of a partner does not empower him to do certain acts. State the acts which are beyond the implied authority of a partner. He cannot admit any liability in any suit against the firm. He cannot refer any dispute to the arbitrator. He cannot relinquish or compromise any debts, or he cannot open a bank account in his own name. He cannot transfer immovable property on behalf of the firm. Transfer means acquire or sale. And he cannot enter into a partnership on behalf of the firm. A, B and C are partners in a firm called ABC firm. A, with the intention of deceiving D, a supplier of office stationery, buys certain stationery on behalf of the firm. The stationery is of use in the ordinary course of the firm's business. A does not give the stationery to the firm, instead brings it to his own use. The supplier D, who is unaware of the private use of the stationery by A, claims the price from the firm. The firm refuses to pay for the price on the ground that the stationery was never received by it. Referring to the provisions of the Partnership Act, whether the firm's contention shall be valid. What would be your answer if part of the stationery so purchased by way A was delivered to the firm by him and the rest was used by him for private use, about which neither the firm nor the supplier D was aware? First of all, as it was already written that the stationery was of use in the ordinary course of the firm's business, is the firm liable? Yes. But ma'am, it was A's fault. So B and C can recover from A, that's a different matter. But to the third party, who is liable? The whole firm is liable. Would your answer be different? No, it will still be the same. So the firm's contention is not tenable for the reason that the partner is in the usual course of the business and on behalf of the firm has an implied authority to bind the firm. In the second case also, the answer would be the same. As above, that is, the implied authority of the partner binds the firm. In both the cases, however, as I told you, the firm can take action against A, but to the outsider, who is liable? The whole firm is liable. What do you mean by implied authority? Point out the extent of partner's implied authority in case of emergency, referring to the provisions of the Indian Partnership Act. Now, in an emergency, a partner can do all the acts that should be done by a person of ordinary prudence. So, to protect the interest of the firm, if he does anything which an ordinary man would do, he would bind the firm. And we have already done what is not implied authority, so not going into that. Mahesh, Suresh and Dinesh are partners in a trading firm. Mahesh, without the knowledge or consent of Suresh and Dinesh, borrows himself ₹50,000 from Ramesh, a customer of the firm, in the name of the firm. Mahesh then buys some goods for his personal use with that borrowed money. Can Mr. Ramesh hold Mr. Suresh and Mr. Dinesh liable? Yes. Taking of loan in case of a trading firm. In case of a trading firm, taking loan is the usual course of the business. We already know that if any act is done in the usual course of the business, it shall bind the firm. For a trading firm, taking loan is the usual course of the business. So, can we say Mahesh has done something which is in the ordinary course of the business? Yes. But ma'am, he bought it for his personal use. So, that doesn't make a difference. He bought it in the name of the firm. Firm is liable. Yes. Suresh and Dinesh can recover it from Mahesh. That's a different case. But to the third party who is liable, the firm is liable. So, Ramesh can hold Suresh and Dinesh liable even though the loan was taken without their consent. What is the provision relating to the effect of notice to an active partner? Notice doesn't only mean necessarily a written notice. Notice also means the knowledge of a fact. Notice to an active partner is deemed to be a notice to the firm. Notice to an active partner is deemed to be a notice to the firm. Now, when we say notice to an active partner is deemed to be a notice to the firm, this notice must be actual and not constructive. That means it should be a real notice. If an active partner knows something which is against the interest of the firm and he knowingly does that act, it is not deemed to be a notice to the firm. If the intention of that acting partner who has the notice is with an intention to deceive the other partners are not bound. So, it is not a real notice. It should be a real notice. If it is with intention to deceive the other partners, he is what? The firm is not bound. So, coming to the notice, notice to one is equivalent to the notice to the rest of the partners. However, the notice must be actual and not constructive. Whether a minor may be admitted to the business of the partnership firm. Explain the rights of a minor in the partnership firm. What are the rights of the minor in a partnership firm? He will have a right to get his profits. Yes, yes, his share of profits. He will have a right to check, inspect and copy accounts of the firm. What accounts of the firm? He will have a right to check, inspect or copy the accounts of the firm. And he will also have a right to sue the other partners for his share. He will also have a right to sue the other partners for his share. If he does not get his share, he will have a right to sue them. But if he cuts off, that is severs all his connections with the firm. So he can sue the other partners, but he has to leave the firm and no longer continue as a beneficiary. On attaining majority, he also has a right to decide whether he wants to continue as a partner or not. So, on attaining majority, within 6 months from the day he comes to know he was a beneficiary or the day he becomes a major, whichever is later, he has a right to decide whether he wants to become a partner of the firm or not. The next one, A, B and C are partners in a firm. As per the terms of the partnership deed, A is entitled to 20% of the partnership property and profits. A retires from the firm and dies after 15 days. B and C continue the business of the firm without settling the accounts. Explain the rights of A's legal representatives against the firm under the Indian Partnership Act. If they continue the business without settling the accounts, the legal heirs will get either the legal heirs will get either the subsequent share of profits or his share will be treated as advance and they will be given interest on advance. Not both, anyone. So either they will have a right to subsequent share of profits, or they will have a right to interest on advance. Interest on advance or subsequent profit, any one will be given, and what they will get, that depends on what they select. Obviously, whichever is higher, I will select that. So share which is attributable to the use of a share in the profit, such shares of the profit that is subsequent, or interest at the rate of 6% per annum. If nothing is given, if something is given in the contract, that rate, otherwise interest at the rate of 6%. So they will have a right to 20% of the share of profits or interest, if nothing is given, at the rate of 6%. Raman Company, a firm, consists of three partners, A, B and C, having 1/3 share each of the firm. According to A and B, the activities are of C are not in the interest of the partnership and thus want to expel C from the firm. Advise A and B whether they can do so, quoting the relevant provisions. Yes, expulsion ke liye, most importantly, what we need is good faith. And for good faith, three things have to be fulfilled. What? It should be he has done anything against the interest of partnership. He has done anything which is against the interest of partnership. He is served with a notice and he is given an opportunity of being heard. That is, he is given a right to speak. If only these three conditions are fulfilled, he can be expelled. So he can be expelled if they expel him in good faith. So in the given case, A and B, the majority partners, can expel the partner only if such expulsion is in good faith as stated above. Messrs. XYZ and Associates, a partnership firm with XYZ as senior partners, were engaged in the business of carpet manufacturing and exporting to foreign countries. On 25th August 2016, they inducted Mr. G. They took Mr. G, an expert in the field of carpet manufacturing, as their partner. On 10 Jan 2018, Mr. G was blamed for unauthorized activities and thus expelled from the partnership by united approval of the rest of the partners. Examine whether the action of the partners is justified or not. What should be the factors to be kept in mind prior to expelling a partner from the firm by other partners according to the provisions of the Indian Contract Act? We already know that for expulsion, we need the consent of majority. Here, the consent of all the three partners is already given. And most importantly, it should be in good faith. Not going into good faith again, because the previous question was about the same thing. So it is justified if they have given a notice and an opportunity of being heard. So as expulsion is in the interest of partnership, it is valid provided he was given a notice and an opportunity of being heard. The factors to be kept in mind is that expulsion should be with the consent of the power of expulsion is given in the contract. It is with the consent of the majority and the expulsion is in good faith. State the modes by which a partner may transfer his shares in the firm in favor of another. What are the rights of such transferee? Transfer can take place by way of sale, pledge or mortgage. This transferee, ironically we say rights, no rights. Yesterday, in the partnership revision video also we had done it. Transferee shall have right to get his share of profits. Yes. Business, right to take part in business? No. Right to check, inspect or copy the accounts of the firm? No. On dissolution, he will be given his share of profits and property. But then, till now, you never allowed me to see the books of accounts. How do I know what is my share? So, a statement of affairs as on that day. As on that day, whatever is the position of the firm shall be given to him. See this, know your share and you will get that. Other than this, no right. So, during the continuous, such transfer is entitled to not entitled to interfere with the conduct of the business, to require the accounts or to inspect the books of accounts. He is only entitled to receive the share of the profits. On dissolution, he will receive the share of the assets of the firm. For that purpose, he will be given an account as on the date of dissolution. Though a minor cannot be a partner, he can nonetheless be admitted to the benefits of partnership. Referring to the provision, state the rights which can be enjoyed by a minor partner. We have already discussed this in the earlier question. State the liabilities before attaining majority. Before attaining majority, no personal liability. He is liable only up to his share in partnership. After attaining majority, he will be liable from the day he was admitted to the benefits of the firm. Not from the day he becomes a major partner notice. No. From the day he was admitted to the benefits of the firm, he is liable. So, liability of a minor before attaining majority, the liability is confined to his share only, no personal liability. After attaining majority, he shall be within 6 months of the day, whichever date is later, when he is elected not to become, he may give public notice and he'll have no rights. But if he fails to give, he shall become a partner in the firm on the expiry of the said notice, and his liability shall be from the day he was admitted to the benefits of the firm. You're supposed to write that also. When he decides not to become a partner, we've already discussed this in the previous question. Ram Mohan and Gopal were partners in a firm. During the course of partnership, the firm ordered Sunrise Limited to supply a machine to the firm. Before the machine was delivered, Ram expired. The machine, however, was later delivered to the firm. Thereafter, the remaining partners became insolvent and the firm failed to pay the price of the machine to Sunrise Limited. Explain with reasons whether Ram's private assets will be liable. No. Because the assets of the deceased partner is liable for the acts done by the firm before his death. Here, they have only placed an order. The goods were never received, he never enjoyed the benefits, so he is not liable. Against whom can the creditor obtain a decree for the recovery of the price? Against the other partners, but not against the deceased partner. So, in this case, will not be liable. The creditors have only a personal decree against the surviving partners. And since they are already insolvent, no suit for the recovery of the debt would lie against them. X, Y, and Z are partners in a partnership firm. They were carrying their business successfully for the past several years. Spouses of X and Y fought in ladies' club on their personal issues. And X's wife was hurt badly. Y got angry on the incident and he convinced Z to expel Y. Is it a valid expulsion? No. Why? Because no good faith. There was interest, yes, but there was no partnership interest. It was only personal interest. Okay, so to the test as required, the expulsion of partner Y is not valid. Mr. A, Mr. B and Mr. C were partners in a partnership firm which is engaged in the business of trading of branded furniture. The name of the partner was clearly written along the firm name in front of the head office of the firm as well as on the letterhead of the firm. On 1st October 2018, Mr. C passed away. His name was neither removed from the list of the partners as stated in front of the head office nor from the letterheads of the firm. As per the partnership terms, the firm continued its operation with Mr. A and Mr. B as partners. The accounts of the firms were settled and the amount due to the legal heirs of Mr. C was also determined. But the same was not paid to the legal heirs of Mr. C. On 16th October, Mr. X, a supplier, supplied furniture worth 20 lakh to the firm. The firm could not repay the amount due to heavy losses. Mr. X wants to recover the amount not only from but also from his legal heirs of Mr. C. Can he recover? No. In case of a deceased partner, even if notice is not given, he is not liable. His estate is liable only for the acts before his death. So, the legal heirs of Mr. C cannot be held liable for the dues towards Mr. X. Mr. M, N and P were partners in a firm which was dealing in refrigerators. On 1st October 2018, Mr. P retired from partnership but failed to give public notice of his retirement. After his retirement, M, N and P visited a trade fair and inquired about some refrigerators with latest techniques. Mr. X, who was exhibiting the furniture with the new techniques, was impressed with the interactions of Mr. P and requested for the visiting cards of the firm. The visiting card also included the name of Mr. P as a partner, even though he had already retired. Mr. X supplied some refrigerators to the firm and could not recover his dues from the firm. Now, Mr. X wants to recover the dues from not only from the firm but also from Mr. P. Analyze the above case in terms of the provisions of the Indian Partnership Act and decide whether Mr. P is liable in the given situation. Here, one thing is very clearly given. He failed to give public notice. He failed to give public notice. If a partner who is supposed to give a public notice retires without giving public notice, he shall be liable for the subsequent acts. Yes or no? Yes, he shall be liable. In this case, he retired without giving a public notice. So, can he be held liable? Yes, P is also liable. State the legal consequences of the following as per the provisions of the Partnership Act. Retirement of a partner, insolvency. Retirement, how can he retire? He can retire either with the consent of all the partners or he can retire by agreement or by giving notice in case of a partnership at will. When he retires, he will have a right to get his share of profits and property and he will be liable only up to the date of his retirement for the acts of the firm. Insolvency, the insolvent partner cannot continue as a partner. The day the court declares him insolvent, he ceases to be a partner of the firm. He does not have to give any public notice. The court's order is a notice. He will have no rights or liabilities over the firm. Distinguish between dissolution of firm and partnership, already done in that revision video also. What are the consequences of non-registration? Three consequences. You cannot sue. Firm cannot sue a third party. Third party can sue? Yes. Cannot claim a set-off of more than rupees 100. I've already told you about mutual set-off, mutual indebtedness in the previous revision video. And partners cannot sue each other except for dissolution. If they want to dissolve the firm, they can sue each other. Otherwise, partners cannot sue each other. But the third party can sue the firm. What is partnership deed? What are the particulars that should be stated? Name of the partners, name of the firm, name and place of the business, date of commencement of partnership, duration of the partnership firm, capital contribution of each partner, profit sharing ratio, admission and retirement, the provisions relating to that, rates of interest on capital, drawings and loans, provision for settlement of accounts for salaries or commission, provisions for expulsion in case of breach of duty or fraud. What is the procedure for registration of the firm? We have to give it to the registrar. The person who have signed or whose name has been given, then the verification of that has to be given. The firm's name cannot contain any words like crown, prince, queen, royal, because they are misleading names. A and company is registered as a partnership firm in 2015 with A, B and C. A, B and C partners. In 2016, A dies. In 2017, B and C sue X in the name and on behalf of A and company without fresh registration. Decide whether the suit is maintainable. To file a case, two things have to be fulfilled. First, the firm should be registered. To file a case on a third party, two things have to be fulfilled. The firm should be registered. Second, partners suing should be named as partners of the firm. Partners suing should be named as partners of the firm. In this case, the firm is a registered firm. So, first condition is fulfilled? Yes. In A dies, but they continue. Who files a case? B and C. B and C, are they named as partners of the firm? Yes. Is the suit valid? Yes. State the grounds on which the firm may be dissolved by the court in insolvency. Except one, all are insolvent or all are dead. Permanent incapacity of an active partner, misconduct of a partner, perpetual losses, consistent breach of contract, partnership business becoming illegal, partnership becoming an illegal association. When does dissolution of partnership take place under the provisions of the Indian Contract Act? Dissolution of partnership can take place as a result of an agreement between the partners. Dissolution of partnership firm, there are two cases, with the order of the court, without the order of the court. With the order of the court, all the cases that we discussed in the prior case. Without the order of the court, it can be by an agreement between the partners, that is the partners mutually decide to dissolve the firm, or it can be by on the happening of certain contingencies. Here there are two grounds, one is compulsory, other is not compulsory. A partner is dead, a partner is insolvent, time is over in case of a particular partnership for a particular period, purpose is over in case of a particular partnership. This is not compulsory, they may continue. Except one, all are dead, except one, all are insolvent. This is a case where it's compulsory for the firm to be dissolved. Subject to an agreement by the partners, state the rules that should be observed by the partners in settling the accounts of the firm after dissolution. So, what are the points that has to be considered? We first pay the outside liabilities. After that, we pay the partner's advance. After that, we pay the partner's capital. And if any surplus is left, then we distribute that surplus in the profit sharing ratio. If my firm's asset is not sufficient to pay up to the capital introduced by the partner, it's a deficit. And in case of deficit, every partner shall contribute to the deficit in their profit sharing ratio. With this, we have completed this. I hope it was of help to you. If it was of help to you, do leave a like and a comment so that we know it helped you. Next, I have been getting so many messages for revision of Companies Act. So the next video will be on the revision of the Companies Act. Happy learning and stay motivated.